Good afternoon and welcome to our event, US and China Energy and Climate Policy and G20. My name is Frank Yotso. I'm the director of the Center for Climate, Economics and Policy here at Crawford School. That's our website. Send us a message if you'd like to be on our mailing list. Just like to take a second to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land, Ngunnawal people, their elders past and present. Now, international climate policy is clearly ramping up. In the lead up to the UN Secretary General Summit in New York in September, also in the lead up, looking a bit further ahead to the December 2015 climate conference, which is meant to come up with an agreement for the post-2020 international climate regime. In Australia, the debate has really still largely been subsumed by the shorter-term policy issues, such as the carbon tax, the emission reduction fund, the fight over the renewable energy target, the question of whether and how we might meet a 5% target at 2020. These issues, of course, matter greatly, but I would argue more for how they're setting our country up towards meeting or not meeting the climate change policy challenge throughout the 2020s and 2030s, rather than over the next 5 or 6 years. So questions are, you know, will we modernise our economy and energy system, or will we try to cling to the past model? Major powers are moving on, thinking about the next decade and beyond, and about climate change commitments to 2030. All countries are called on to submit their nationally determined contributions to international climate policy in the first half of 2015. And increasingly, I think it's fair to say, climate change policy is not seen as something environmental, but a question of economics, of the quality of economic growth, a question of energy security, and also a question of strategic positioning. Who will be the dominant energy suppliers in a world that may opt for a low-carbon pathway? Who will be the suppliers of technology, of new energy technologies? The Obama administration, of course, recently, and we will hear about that in our second talk today, has put forward a plan to regulate the power sector to achieve a targeted 30% emissions reduction at 2030 relative to 2005 in the US power sector. Europe has put on the table a target of a 40% reduction in emissions at 2030 relative to 1990, approximately equivalent to about 35% relative to 2005. And perhaps most importantly, China. We see very strong statements out of Beijing these days on climate policy, on energy policy. It seems to be a strong commitment to limit carbon emissions, especially limiting the use of coal with a very proximate driver, the air pollution in the major cities, but also broader concerns about energy security and ultimately climate change as well. Now, pressure is increasing, I think it's fair to say, in Australia to somehow come to the party or at least make clear what the position internationally is. And one manifestation of that, quite apart from the kind of discussions that we've seen between Prime Minister and President Obama, one manifestation is that international partners are calling for climate change to be included on the agenda of the G20 leaders' summit meeting in November in Brisbane. Now, to discuss all of these issues, we've got five eminent experts here today. We've got Dr. Fuchiang Yang, who is Senior Advisor to the US Natural Resource Defense Council on Climate Change. Dr. Yang was previously Director of Global Climate Solutions at WWF International, and he's got a very long experience in involvement in energy and climate change matters. He worked with China's Energy Research Institute and other institutions before moving to the US in the 1980s. We've got Mr. Matt Murray here, who's Economic Affairs Counselor at the US Embassy in Canberra, and who has also spent a number of years in diplomatic postings in China. So he knows very well about both countries that we're discussing about today, just as Dr. Yang does, of course. We're fortunate also to have our colleague, Professor Hugh White here, who's Professor of Strategic Studies at ANU. and whose interests include the development of US-China strategic relations. He's been a senior advisor to several ministers and prime ministers in the past, and has been very visible in the Australian international debate about strategic aspects around the China-US relationship. We also have our colleague, Professor Shumei Bai from Fenner School of Environment, who has recently published an article in Nature Journal on China's urbanisation, and she will provide us with a perspective on the question of urbanisation and how that relates to energy and climate change challenge. And finally, we have Mr. Paul Toney, who is WWF's National Manager for Science Policy and Government Partnerships. And Paul is involved in the preparation and putting in place of the C20 summit, which is taking place, I think, later this week in Melbourne. So this is the Community 20 summit, the aim of which is to provide community organisation and for the community input into the G20 deliberation. So the way we'll handle this today is we'll have presentations, all five presentations up first, and then we'll have, I think we'll have plenty of time for discussion, Q&A, panel discussion at the end. So without further ado, let me call on Dr. Young and make him welcome.
Thanks a lot, Frank, for your kind of introduction. Today, I would like to introduce what is a China energy issue and climate change. And China now is the largest energy consumption and producers in the world, also is the second largest economy in the world. And if I summarize my presentation, I would like to focus on the 4 points that is in the top of Chinese agenda. And first is energy security, and second is energy transition, and particularly is stimulate development for the renewables and other clean energies. And third one, that is quite important, is phase out the fossil fuels. And fourth is related to the energy, related to climate change and Chinese, the position is towards to the climate negotiation and action in the domestic, and I think that's my focus today. And from these slides, you can see the Chinese government have put very conservative GDP growth rate, but actually the GDP growth rate is much higher than the Chinese government determined. And you can see the green line is the government determine the GDP growth rate in the every 5 years, but actually the GDP growth rate, you can see the yellow line actually is much higher. So in the last decade, you can see the Chinese GDP annually is growth is about 9.8%, and that is driven energy consumption is much higher, and that is a very concern is about all the pollutants and the CO2 emissions. But now the China, the GDP growth rate now is a slow down little, very significant, and that's you can see that is a help for the CO2 emission reduction and the energy consumption, and improved energy efficiency and renewables. From these slides, you can see that China, last decade, energy consumption is increased significantly, and particularly for the coal. Coal is still dominant. In the 1990s, and coal consumption is reduced, but however, another the economy booming and drive the coal come back again. Now coal is account 66% of last year in the total energy mix. And others, clean energy, you can see oil and steel is about 18%, but gas is only 5%, and renewable is 8.4%. And so now the question is we try to focus in the two areas. And first is reduce the coal consumption. And for NRDC, now we have a study we call the coal cap in China. That means when the China coal consumption will reach the peak point and then decline. And we think that is quite important. If China cannot get rid of the coal, and so any, you know, you change the economy structure, you have a low carbon green economy, or if you protect the environment and protect the public health, that is only impossible to do so. Another is that we China like to develop more gas. That is intermediate energy. But in the future, that's we like to see the high penetration development for the renewables. And for coal consumption, you can see China now is cause a lot of problem for the environment, particularly for the air pollution. And PM2.5, and that is a popular word used in China. If you search the newspaper or other, you know, people concerned, and that is on the top three. And so you can, and public is complaining very loudly. So that's driven the government have to concern reduce the PM2.5. And that now Chinese government does issue very strong regulation to limit PM2.5. But however, behind that 2.5 emissions, and that is the coal consumption. You can see from this picture in the Beijing area, and that is the 30th capital in the world. And so we think we have to change. So in the next 10 years, if you travel to China, you still not see the clean up for the air. So you can see China still, the energy still is dominated by the coal. Of course, in the city and transportation area is also a major concern. But for us, is you know, this is across national wide. So that issue is the coal consumption. And we have a study, and before 7 years ago, we worked with Greenpeace China to carry out study. And this study showed us the total losses and damage of the due to the coal consumption is about 7 to 9% of total annually GDP. So that is a lot. And recently, we carry out study, and we like to see what is this kind of loss and damage in 2012. And so recently, the study will show us maybe if we not stop the coal consumption, that annually losses will be profit will increase. And for the cities, we concern about transportation sector. And China, for the coal the sale before, a couple years before, is about 30% of increase annually. Even the economy go to lower growth rates, and you can see the car sales still is 17 or 15%, and that is a large. And so China now will import more oil from outside China to support the growth in the transportation sector. So the energy security now is become top of the policy in Chinese government. You can see oil actually now is account 55, or last year actually is 58% of the oil is imported. And for the natural gas now is 30%. And for the coal, China is rich in coal resources, but still in the coastal area import coal, and that annually is increased to the 300 million tons of coal imported, most from Australia. And even including the U.S., Indonesia, and other countries. And so in the future, and if we are not surprised by the 2020, if oil and natural gas is oil increased to the 65%, and natural gas to 40%, or even increase in the coal, and you know, so don't surprise. In the future, maybe the reliance on the imported petroleum will be more than U.S. U.S., I guess, in the historical highest is about 67 or 68%, 65%. But China, I think 2030, probably will be 30%. And we have a story, and now in U.S., we can see the shale gas is a change, the map of the world energy supply and demand. But they have some prediction. So U.S. by 2030 will become net energy export. But this is uncertain, but we don't sure this will happen or not. But for China and India, we'll import more energy, that is for sure. So what is the energy map in the world? And you can see that Asia now is a dominant for the energy consumption and production. And so in the future, and we like to see the Asia become the center of the energy consumption in the world. So we have a joke. We say, how about the IEA, their office have to move from Paris to Beijing or to Tokyo? And because I think in the future they don't function well, because no India and China or other Japan, you know, participate, you know, this, you know, the IEA, and or if no new world, if the IEA don't change their rules, and they will lose their function. So what is Asia in the future? So we think now is a question. We think about what is we can do in Asia. This is a map about what is countries in this Asia, because in a culture, in an organization, in a sports or others, Asia actually is a kind of a unity, and is a unit, and they can people can work together, government to work together, and find solutions for the common challenges. And so we think, if in this case, how about the Asia energy in the future? And if we see the oil, the left hand is the oil production and consumption, you can see actually they have actual oil can support Asia demand for the oil, and natural gas almost, but also for the coal. But coal reserve in Asia is a big, but international coal the trading is the price is more competitive. So for the Asia, they will import more coal. And so in this case, they have two uncertain factors I would like to mention. One is what is Russia, and what is Australia, and because Russia, you know, territory, and they actually is belong most part of the land is in Asia. So I think is because now the tension between the Asia, the Russia and the EU and United States may be forced Russia, you know, move to the Asia, to the East. And for the Australia, and I guess they have a much close tie with Asia. So if we put these two figures in this, we can see actually for this region can be balanced. So we like to see in the future in Asia, we like to see they have a kind of is a physical organization can be established to deal with the supply and demand, rather than say they have a tension or they have a struggle between the IEA and OPEC. And so we like to see this can work or not, this kind of strategies, the producer, the export and the import and consumers, and what they have any new policy and regulation can establish to avoid a kind of fighting or conflict between these two groups. And for China, I think is to replace coal, we have to develop a more natural gas. And shale gas is a rich resources in China. in the estimation is about 25 trillion BCU is a billion cubic meters. So I guess that is a lot, is more than, but based on the US or Chinese estimation is a little bit more than US total reserve in the shale gas. But in the shale gas development, we have to concern about the environment, particularly for the water, land, air pollution, methane leakage, or the community and noise, or other CO2 emissions. So we think if the methane leakage is about 4% in the shale gas development, that is not worthwhile for the development natural gas, because that's to replace the CO2 emission from coal, it doesn't make sense. But unfortunately, in China, you can see these slides, and the shale gas and the coal reserve actually is overlapped with this area. They have water scarcity. And so that's if you develop the shale gas, you use more. I have been in the field and to check what is the natural gas development in China, in Sichuan area. And we find out China, the shale gas development will use more water than the US, and based on the statistics data. And they have, in US, 25% or 30%, the water will come back to the ground. But China, actually, if you put water in for the fracking, but disappear. So that means China will consume more water for shale gas development. And so that is a challenge. And for natural gas, you can see this map, and China will the Asia Central country, and that's by 2020 is about 80 BCU pipeline natural gas from that area. And in the southern China, you can see from Burma, and that is 12 BCU annually from this area. And how about Russia? So now is a big concern about the relationship between Russia and China. But I will say, don't think this is a political issue. Some kind of that. But also is a economical and energy issues. And so sign a long-term contract, and that's media interest and report a lot. And from this map, you can see that China in the east part, annually China will import about 38 BCU. Now is the negotiate about the west part, and that is about 30 BCU. So total, that is about 70 BCU and annually. But also, these two parts have an oil pipeline. So that's about 20 to 30 billion, 20 to 30 million tons of the oil will import from Russia. So we can see if the tension between the Russia and the EU and the US will not deal, cannot settle down, and Russia definitely will move forward to the Asia. For the renewable, everybody say, yeah, China consume a lot of oil and coal. How about the renewable? Actually, China is the number one renewable development in the world. And you can see annually, and Chinese government changed the target for the renewables. For instance, for the cell, for the solar PV, and now by 2015, that is about 35 gigawatt for solar PV. But maybe this year and not next year, China will exceed the Germany, become a number one for the solar PV. And in the future, you can see, the renewable will come. Share a significant part of the energy consumption mix, and total investment is more than 50 to 60 billion US dollars annually. But that will increase in the future. Now we study about what is a renewable high penetration in China. So we like to see by 2030, 27% of renewables will account in the total energy mix, and 2050 actually is dominant, and can be 50% or not, at least is 40%. If they are 40% and the coal consumption will be lower than the 30%, or other will be oil and or natural gas. So that is why from these slides you can see the for the wind, and that's a blue color, actually is the number one in the world. And so for the power generation, even for China, we say 2030, they have no new coal-fired power plant. But we don't think this is too conservative. How about 2025? There are no new coal-fired power plant. So all of these will be filled in this energy demand either by the natural gas or by the renewables. And how about climate change? Everybody knows China is number one emitters in the world. And they have many studies to show, and China have to do a more activity to reduce CO2 emission. And before they have many studies and say that China probably will get a peak for the emission by 2030. Now 2035. Now most Chinese experts get consensus. Maybe 2030. And so you can see the Reuters have a report, the Chinese experts, they say, I think 2030 is a conservative target. But what is a recently study? And this is based on our study. You can see scenarios is 2040, but if we have a 2 degrees scenario, and that is 2020, but if we have a more aggressive one, and 2025 is a probably. But in here, I would like to say maybe between 2025 to 2030 is more safe for me, and to say we'll reach the peak point. But we like to see 2025, and so that is give Chinese how can you establish strategies to reduce the CO2 emission? We think use the market mechanism, maybe that works. Because for the Chinese government, traditionally, they like to use administrative forces and to force the business circle and ask the public to support their business policies. But however, for China now is established ETS in 5 cities and in 2 provinces. And so far, we cannot say is successful, but we can say probably for myself, I'm more conservative. I would say 50% is successful, even 50% failure. But say I will say that is a more valuable experience we can learn. If we cannot learn from the failure, but in the future maybe that is dangerous for national ETS levels. But if we can learn from our the failure, so the lessons we can get, that is much more helpful, is much more valuable. So now in China, because for the pollution, and they will expand these cities to the region. For instance, in the Beijing, Tianjin, and that is So that is very close. And we argue is a city, maybe the boundary is too small. So now they will expand to the Hebei, this area. So in this area, so we can see more. And if we can also get more lessons from regional, and so we like to see in the 2020 can establish the national ETS level. And for the Chinese government officials, they even say in the following 3 years, they can establish the Chinese national ETS, but I will say probably not, because China is so big, our legal system, our data system, our MRV system or our system is not ready yet. That's slow, but not stop is better than too quick. So I think by 2020, if China can build up this kind of ETS in the national level, so I think that is in the world, that is the biggest market. And China now urbanization is go very fast. In the 2030, and 70% of the people, of the population will live in the urban area. And so now challenge, you know, for other developed country, their challenge is one by one, in the one period, they cope with this challenge to find solution for that. And for instance, for the pollution in the 50s, 60s, 70s. And then they find other water solution and now climate change. But in China, all these challenges is together. So we think is, for instance, for the direct countries, they only in the population get to the 70% in the city, they think about what is a low carbon green city. But in China, we say, how about our city? Population is go to 65 or 6%. Can we make this city become much more green and low carbon? So that is a challenge. We cannot wait until then. If there, in this case, if we cannot find solution for cities, also, we have no way to get a solution for the national. And for the Chinese position in the climate change negotiation, everybody is a very interested. I think is China. Now China, EU, and US, that is, we call this is gold triangles. So now the question is, how about these three countries or unities or union, and they can make a contribution for the climate change negotiation. Now EU, the President Obama have a more aggressive, the plan for the power plant sector. And for EU, they're traditionally, and that is like to play leadership in a negotiation. For China, usually, they're in the 1990s, they are very conservative. They say, this is not job, and we like to see what is the developed country demonstrate they play leadership, cut CO2 emissions. But now, suddenly, they become a number one emitter in the world. They have to adjust themselves, what they can do about it. And so for Chinese government, actually, now is in the top concern. For the Mr. Xie Zhenhua, he is chair of the Chinese delegation. He said in the March next year, Chinese leaders will say something about ambitious. That's quote his word, ambitious power plant. So we open our eyes and see what is the ambitious Chinese the plan for the put on the table for the 2015 Paris negotiation. But I think is that China now, I like to encourage China to play leadership, but leadership in the Chinese world is not so positive. And sometimes if they, understand. So for the Chinese traditional, they like to see, I like to behind the leader, I like to watch what he did, what he did something successfully, something wrongly, and so I can do something better than him. So now suddenly he's in the front. So we like to see Chinese government play leadership. Thank you very much.
Yes, hello everybody. I'm very happy to be here at the ANU. Thank you very much, Frank, for the invitation. And it's really an honor for me to be on a panel with Dr. Yang and Dr. White, Dr. Bai, and Paul Tony from WWF. It's really a great group that Frank has pulled together. So in the time I have allotted today, I don't have a PowerPoint, so we can leave that one up there. But I really want to cover four things. The first is, some of the progress that we've made domestically in the United States on combating climate change and addressing reducing carbon emissions. Second, how we see the upcoming international climate negotiations and the other sort of multilateral things that we do to address this issue. Third, I want to hit on our climate, specifically on our climate cooperation with China and the work that we're doing there, and Dr. Yang's already alluded to a lot of that. And fourth, really set to the opportunities we see where we can engage in the G20. But the basis for all of this really is President Obama's climate action plan, which probably many of you have seen, taken a look at. It was announced in June of last year when the president said, you know, we really want to basically up our game to the next level on addressing carbon emissions in the United States, as well as working with international partners to address the issue globally. And what, in the president's words, he said that, you know, America stands at a critical juncture to help put us and the world on a sustainable long-term trajectory on climate. And as all of you probably know, the president's already made a commitment in 2009 that the United States would reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 17% over 2005 levels. We'd do that by 2020. So, you know, this is really the task before us. The Climate Action Plan has three parts. It aims to cut carbon pollution in America, first and foremost, to prepare the United States for the impacts of climate change, and third, to lead international efforts to combat global climate change and prepare for its impacts. The good news, and there is a lot of good news, is that in 2012, carbon emissions from the energy sector in the United States fell to its lowest level in two decades. So from the time I was in the seats that all of you students are in until now, about 20 years, we've gone back to that level. And at the same time, America's net oil imports have fallen to their lowest level in 20 years as well. And as Dr. Yang indicated, we hope to be able to become energy sufficient here in the near future. The bad news, though, is that there's still so much more work to be done. If you've seen the National Climate Assessment that came out in the United States just last month, it indicated that climate change already is happening across the United States, and many Americans are feeling the effects in a variety of ways. On the domestic front, and in terms of what we've been able to do domestically in the United States, if I could just leave you with one key point today, it would be that there has not been simply one key silver bullet to addressing these issues and reducing carbon emissions. The Climate Action Plan, as well as the President's all of the above energy strategy, both attest that there are many, many ways the United States is working on reducing emissions in pursuit of a clean energy future. And our ambassador, John Berry, highlighted a lot of these when he was in Melbourne last month at the Australian Emission Reduction Summit that the Carbon Market Institute hosted in Melbourne. And we need to continue to work in these areas. If I could just highlight a few of them, the policy includes cutting carbon pollution for power plants. We've more than doubled electricity generation from renewables. We've increased government funding for clean energy innovation, which we see is very important. We've increased fuel economy standards because vehicles are such a large part of the problem in the United States. We've developed advanced transportation technologies, reduced energy bills through efficiency upgrades. Energy efficiency is obviously a very important part of all this. We've curbed the emissions of hydrofluorocarbons, reduced methane emissions, and worked on preserving forest resources. So it's a very multifaceted approach. It's not just focused on one specific area. And on the first point, cutting carbon pollution from power plants, as Frank mentioned, I mean, it's important to note that, we've again made some progress here recently in prioritizing carbon pollution from power plants, which in the United States account for 40% of our emissions. And the EPA took that step a couple of weeks ago, announcing the Clean Power Plan, which would produce a rule, which proposed a rule, to limit carbon dioxide emissions from U.S. power plants, where we would work together with our states to reduce the emissions by a further 30% by 2030. In addition, as Dr. Yang was just talking about, the shale gas revolution in the United States has really changed things through the development of innovative technologies and sound policy support to produce more natural gas. And as we've increased production of natural gas, that's obviously a comparatively cleaner source of energy, and has also contributed to reducing emissions. And finally, on the domestic side, I don't have time to go into it in detail today, but it would be remiss if I didn't mention that while these are the steps the federal government is taking, there are also a number of steps that our state governments are taking. In particular, California and New York are some of the ones you read about in terms of their own very aggressive policies to reduce carbon emissions, including in California, emissions trading. So on the international side, I would point out that just as our domestic progress on reducing emissions is the result of advances in several areas, so too the United States' international engagement is a very multifaceted approach. So in 2009, President Obama helped launch the Major Economies Forum on Energy and Climate, which is a high-level forum that brings together 17 countries that account for approximately 75% of global greenhouse gas emissions. And the goal of that forum is really to support the international climate negotiations and to spur cooperative action to combat climate change. And one outcome of that, of the MEF, was the launch of the Clean Energy Ministerial as well. The United States also has supported emission reduction efforts through other multilateral mechanisms, such as the Climate and Clean Air Coalition to reduce short-lived climate pollution, as well as promoting clean energy solutions through regional efforts like the U.S.-Asia-Pacific Comprehensive Energy Partnership. And of course, as Frank and Dr. Yang have just highlighted, the United States remains very committed to what's going on here to work through the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change to negotiate a new international climate agreement applicable to all countries in 2015 and to take effect in 2020. I think you said that the China word is ambitious. We have three words. The agreement should be ambitious, inclusive, and flexible. And we really want to work with all countries through this process to make that agreement a reality. And so I also want to highlight, again, because the topic of today, it's really critically important that the United States engage bilaterally with emerging economies, including China. And so I just want to talk a little bit about China for a second. I'm definitely very passionate about U.S.-China cooperation on all fronts. I spent 7 years in China, 4 years in Beijing, 3 years in Shanghai. Then when I was back in Washington, I was really focused on China for a couple of years on the staff of our Undersecretary of State. And it's really been, for myself personally, pretty amazing over the last 10 years to see how much we've opened dialogues with China on a whole range of areas, economic, environment, energy related, and to see how far we've come since 2004 really gives me a lot of optimism about the relationship in many ways. Dr. Yang already did an excellent job of outlining the challenges China faces in its domestic energy situation, and as well as the changes that the Chinese leadership is making to try to address those challenges. And one of the things I learned during my time in China is that while it's always very easy sometimes to, as an outsider, criticize decisions that are being made by the Chinese government, it's far more difficult probably to actually be the person that's trying to make these changes and to be the leaders in charge of making those changes. So it would be tough to want to swap spots with Xi Jinping or Xie Zhenhua or anybody else that's really charged with making those decisions, because those are some tough decisions that need to be made. Certainly from the U.S. perspective, when we look and see that as the two largest emitters of greenhouse gases, the United States and China really do need to play key roles in any effort to combat global climate change. And President Obama and as well as Secretary of State Kerry, since he came into office last year, have really worked very hard to elevate climate change in our relationship with China. During his first trip to China last year, Secretary Kerry announced the launch of the U.S.-China Climate Change Working Group, which then met during our strategic and economic dialogue in Washington last July, and which has continued over the course of the last year. We are now engaged in a constructive and high-level collaboration with China on climate change, including, as many of you know, a breakthrough agreement at the presidential level to phase down hydrofluorocarbons, as well as concrete initiatives in key sectors and a dialogue about our post-2020 plans to limit greenhouse gas emissions. I think it's really important here, too, to go back to Dr. Yang's presentation, which emphasizes, how focused the Chinese domestic leadership is on this issue. and which has definitely given us an opportunity to talk more with China about ways we can cooperate. In the case of the air pollution indicator, the PM2.5, an interesting footnote to that is it was really the U.S. Embassy putting an air quality monitor on it, on the roof of its building several years ago when I was there, that really started to get that conversation going, which I think is something that we're all very proud of in the State Department, and having played a role in that kind of engagement, which is, I would say, is, you know, a good example of 21st century diplomacy, thinking outside the box a little bit. And the big thing too was that it involved using social media to get the actual scores on 2.5 PM2.5 out, which then was getting picked up within the Chinese population. And that's where, as well, the, you know, there's definitely a focus in this U.S.-China discussion about the impacts of climate change on health, the impacts of air pollution on health, and how we can work together to really move forward. The U.S.-China Climate Change Working Group that I mentioned is aimed at encouraging large-scale cooperation to address climate change. There are five initial areas of cooperation under the working group to address some of the key drivers of greenhouse gas emissions and air pollution in our countries. Those include emissions reduction from heavy-duty and other vehicles, smart grids, carbon capture, utilization, and storage, collecting and managing greenhouse gas emissions data, and energy efficiency in buildings and industry, all of which we think are very important. So in short there, I mean, the United States and China together are taking important steps to curb greenhouse gas emissions, and we welcome further cooperation to meet this challenge, as well as working within the UNFCCC process. Finally, with respect to the G20, you know, as President Obama has emphasized, 2014 is a critical year for action on climate change, and leaders of the world's largest economies do have a responsibility to help galvanize action toward an ambitious agreement at the UNFCCC process that sets clear long-term plans to substantially reduce emissions. G20 leaders have said that the G20 will be the premier forum for international economic cooperation. We believe that if that commitment is to be credible, then they must take on the most important issues and seek common ground in international negotiations and drive concrete action at national levels. The dramatic increase in time and attention devoted to climate in the U.S.-China relationship that I just outlined is further evidence of how important this issue is to two of the world's leading economies, largest economies. And just like promoting trade or reducing tax evasion or strengthening financial regulation, addressing climate change is, we believe, a core international economic priority that we would expect G20 leaders to discuss. I know that President Obama and Prime Minister Abbott just last week discussed the importance of the G20's leadership across the board, including on climate, during their discussions in Washington. And we definitely want to continue to work with all G20 members on this issue. So with that, in the interest of time, I'll wrap up here, but I look forward to the panel discussion and your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Matt. I think that was very clear, actually. Matt's boss, the ambassador, gave a speech this morning across the lake at the Alliance 21 conference on the Australia-US relationship. That's a forum that's traditionally focused on security issues. Quite tellingly, the first, if I may call it, the first substantive session this morning was actually on energy, and in that session, climate change policy, low carbon policy kept coming up. So quite significant in that regard. So I've managed to do the introduction into security issues. Hugh White, the floor is yours.
Well, thanks, Frank. It's a great pleasure to be here and to join this conversation. You know, the premise behind our session today, I guess, is very obviously that as the US and China are the world's two biggest economies and all of that, what we can do as a global community about climate change is going to be fundamentally influenced by what those two countries can do separately and what they can agree to do together. And my contribution to the conversation is to just make some observations about how what that might mean, what they can do individually and what they can do together, will be affected by their relationship with one another. And that is, that relationship is both an extraordinarily important one and also extraordinarily strange and remarkable. It's important, of course, because they are the world's two strongest countries and will remain that way until India catches up with one of them, and that might be quite a long time in the future. And it's remarkable because what we've seen over the last couple of decades in the rise of China economically is the fastest and swiftest change in the distribution of power in the world in history. And because power affects relationships in so many complicated ways, this has enormous implications for the kind of relationship they have. The fact that that growth has taken place in China has absolutely been the product and has been able to take place so fast has absolutely been a reflection of the emergence of a thoroughly globalised economy. Without globalisation, China couldn't have grown as fast as it has. And that means that these two economies are deeply interdependent. Not just the economies, the societies are deeply interdependent in ways that major economies have never been before, to a degree that major economies have never been before, but they are also deeply competitive. And we have never seen in history the emergence of such, if I can put it this way, a classically competitive relationship between an established power and a rising power, as we have between the US and China today, in a context in which they are so interdependent with one another, and there's no area in which that interdependence is more sort of prominent or significant than in the area of their response to the challenges of carbon pollution and climate change. And I just want to talk a little bit about how that plays out. I mean, the good news is that that the US and China, because of that interdependence and because of goodwill on both sides, have a formidable capacity to cooperate. We wouldn't be living in the world we're living in today if that wasn't so. We wouldn't be living in the world we're living in today if the US and China hadn't reached an agreement about the nature of their relationship, actually back in 1972 when Nixon went to China, which provided the foundation for 30 years and for 40 years, and particularly in the last 30 years, of very deep understanding between the US and China about some shared objectives and understandings and so on. And that has been extremely successful, and in all kinds of ways, as Matt said, there's a formidable array of ways in which the US and China do cooperate and work well together. And in a sense, you could say that cooperation has made the world we live in today. But there is also competition there. And partly because I'm in the strategic policy business and therefore a bit inclined to be gloomy, I want to talk about that competition and just say a little bit about it, where I think it's going and how I think it might affect the capacity to cooperate across the board and on climate change issues specifically. The first point to make is that when people talk about the US and China as strategic competitors or rivals, they tend to focus on a series of specific issues. Some weeks it's climate change, it's cyber espionage. Some weeks it's crises in the South China Sea, some weeks it's crises in the East China Sea. But they look at a series of specific points or problems or disagreements. I don't think that gets at the nature of the problem, because I don't think disagreements, real and important though they are, between the US and China on things like cyber espionage or maritime issues in the East or South China Sea, I don't think they are the causes of the sense of strategic rivalry. I think they're symptoms of it. I think the causes lie much deeper. And they go fundamentally to different views in Washington and Beijing, and you might say more broadly in the two communities, in America and China, of the nature of their relationship and their respective roles in Asia. What's been special and beneficial about the last 40 years since Nixon went to China is that there's been broad convergence between the US and China on that issue. But what's been special about the last few years, let's say the last 5 years, is that consensus has started to break down. and is broken down because the United States' principal objective has been to preserve the status quo in Asia, preserve the relationship, the nature of the relationship, which both accepted back in 1972. And that was a relationship based on US primacy as a foundation for the Asian order. And just to be clear, speaking as an Australian, that's fine by me. I'd like nothing better than the status quo to last forever. But it doesn't seem to be fine by China. Big subject, I won't go into it now, but to put it briefly, when President Xi Jinping says that he wants a new model of great power relations, I think he means exactly what he says. That means he doesn't like the old model anymore. It's worked for them until now. It doesn't work in future. So China wants a different kind of relationship with the United States than the one the United States wants with China. And not to put too fine a point on it, China wants to be treated at least as an equal in China's terms. What does that mean? Big subject for later. But to be treated as an equal in China's terms. And the United States wants to preserve what American political leaders continue to refer to as leadership with a capital L. I added the capital L, but you know what I mean. And the problem is that for both of them, very deep questions of identity and status are tied up with those ideas. And countries do terrible things to themselves and to one another in pursuit of questions of identity and status. Now, that's not to say, of course, that either side wants rivalry or competition. They both want peace. They both want cooperation. They both understand how important it is to both of them that they preserve the pattern of cooperation which I referred to before. But they both believe, I fear, that they can achieve their objectives, in America's case preserving the status quo, in China's case reshaping the regional order quite fundamentally. They both believe they can achieve that without risking rivalry and confrontation, because they both think the other side's going to give way. Most Americans, I believe, don't really take China's challenge seriously. And I fear that many Chinese believe that the United States are ready, to use a bit of Australian vernacular, to tap the mat. And one can see why they might think that. I think they're wrong to think that, I might say, but you can see why they might think that. And so both underestimate the power and resolve of the other, and therefore both underestimate the need to compromise with the other, to step back from their preferred outcome and try and find a reconciliation with the other in order to avoid the clash that both would like to avoid. I don't want to over-dramatise things, but this is how wars start. They don't start because one side, usually they don't start because one side or the other thinks, wouldn't a war be great? They start because each side thinks that they don't have to give away things that they really value because they think the other side will step back so they don't have to. I think that's exactly the kind of problem we're facing between the US and China at the moment. Now, I happen to think they're both wrong. I happen to think the chances of either stepping back completely is very low. I don't believe China will accept the status quo in Asia. And I don't believe the United States is ready to step back as much as China would probably prefer. That's why the risk of rivalry is very real. It's not inevitable, of course. Absolutely not inevitable. There's no reason why the US and China shouldn't build a perfectly sustainable long-term relationship in which both sides can cooperate, continue to cooperate very, very effectively. But it won't be on the basis of US withdrawal from Asia, and it won't be on the basis of continued US primacy. It will have to be on the basis that neither side really wants. It's called compromise. It's pretty tough, but it's the only way to resolve these sorts of issues. In the end, neither side is strong enough to face the other down. Now, of course, whilst that process is unfolding, cooperation on all sorts of specific issues is possible, as we've seen. I think we've seen quite clear evidence of escalating strategic rivalry on the one hand, and increased cooperation, particularly on issues of climate change, just over the last 12 months or so, in the way that Matt, for example, referred to. So it's, you know, this is not all doom and gloom, but this context of strategic rivalry does affect the prospects for action on climate change, both individually and collectively. That is what each country will do about its energy position and what they will be able to do together. And I think we could say this, the four ways in which this could happen. The first is that it will is a question about how they see their own economies and how willing they are, therefore, to take risks or to pay costs to move to a lower carbon economy under pressure from economic competition with the other. That is, political leaders have a lot of things in mind when they think about economic choices. They think about the well-being of their citizens and so on. But as strategic rivalry escalates between the US and China, if it escalates, then thinking about how their economy stacks up in relation to the other, in quite competitive, zero-sum terms, I think is likely to be an increasingly large, well, there's a risk that it'll be an increasingly large part of the picture. Now, how does that cut? If people see advantages in moving to a low-carbon economy, that might be good news. They might compete benevolently with one another to try and do better. But if they see them as negatives, then that could be a disincentive. And I think there is a risk of that. I might say I think that might be a particular risk in the United States, because I think the United States is at some stage coming in for a shock. If I might be wrong about this, but I don't think I've ever heard a US political leader say the following words out loud: before long, China's economy will be bigger than ours, and we will no longer be the biggest economy in the world. Now, some stage, some American political leader is going to have to start explaining that reality to the American public, and it might be a very scary moment, and it might produce some pretty wacky policies. The second is the question of energy security. This is a very big subject in itself. Normally people in my business go on about energy security a great deal. I'm not going to say very much about it, because I think for both US and China, energy security is not actually that big a deal. I think as long as they can avoid all-out conflict, the chances of either interfering with the energy flows of the other are very low. And there's quite a lot of history behind that. I won't go into it. But I will say that questions about energy security nonetheless get mixed up with other questions about the energy economy in very complex ways, particularly, again, in the US, but I think perhaps also in China to some extent. A lot of the conversations in the United States about issues that are most properly seen as related to climate change are mixed up with the US concern about energy dependence on energy imports. And this is a distraction. I don't think the US really has an energy security problem, at least not of that form. But if strategic rivalry with China escalates, concerns about energy security will come into the debate even more and perhaps distort judgments that might be better made in other ways. The third is the way in which the sense of competition could intrude into negotiations between the US and China about what they're prepared to agree to, particularly in Paris next year. To the extent that there's a sense of rivalry between them, makes compromise harder, and particularly harder to sell domestically. In order to get a deal, and I think this probably applies in both ways, it's a bit more opaque, at least to someone like me who doesn't profess to be an expert in Chinese internal politics, but on both sides, it'll be harder to sell significant compromises with the other side if they're seen to be compromises with a country with which they're a strategic rival. So, for example, if the United States has to accept to be more accommodating of China's argument that because America had 200 years head start with the Industrial Revolution, China should be given more space than America is, you can see how the argument about that in domestic politics in the United States, the administration's capacity to sell that to the Congress and more broadly, is going to be made harder the more China is seen as a rival. And the trend over the last year or so there has not been positive. If those trends continue, it's going to be harder and harder for American leaders to sell a compromise deal with China to their electorates, and quite possibly in a more complex but perhaps just as real way, conversely in China as well. And the last, of course, is the risk that rivalry turns into conflict. I don't want to overstress this. I certainly don't believe that that's in China is inevitable, but it is not a negligible risk. China and Japan are regularly risking a direct military confrontation in the East China Sea. The chances of one of those incidents turning into an actual exchange of fire or loss of platforms is, I'm going to give you a totally bogus piece of quantification, maybe 5% between now and the Paris meeting. If that happens, then the chances of the United States, the chances of that escalating to a larger China-Japan conflict is very high. And if that happens, the chances of the United States being drawn in is very high, 80% or 90% in each case. So the risks of an actual clash are not low. And if that happens, the chances of a satisfactory deal on any other issue, no matter how important it seems, will go by the board. So that is a significant factor. Now, I wish I could finish my talk by giving you a snappy idea as to how we can fix that problem and get away with it, get away from it. I haven't got that bit yet, I'm afraid. Thank you.
Thanks, Frank, for inviting me to this event. It's a great pleasure to be here. As Frank just mentioned, I'm not going to talk about energy or carbon, but I'll be talking about one of the most important major sort of transition or a process ongoing in China, which has profound implications for energy and carbon emission that is discussed here, which is rapid urbanization. And I'll talk about it in particular in relation to the recently released National New Type Urbanization Strategy, which will be guiding China's urbanization process over the next, until 2020 at the least. First of all, I would like to start with some background. Some of you might know that China has really been urbanizing rapidly. In 1978, China has only 17.9 or 17.8% of people, its population, living in cities. But by 2012, this ratio has raised to 52.6%. Well, those numbers are just very dry statistics. But if I say each 1% increase means 14 million population moving into cities, probably that can give you a better idea what is the, you know, the magnitude and scale and speed. And it looks like this process is going to continue until 2020 at the least, because the new type urbanization strategy released by the Chinese government says that it is aiming to achieve a 60% of urbanization ratio by 2020, which means a 1 percentile increment each and every year until then. So again, each and every year we'll be having 40 million population moving into cities from the rural area. So in a recent paper, like Frank mentioned, we published a paper in Nature. In this particular paper, I argued that I think this particular process is the biggest, if not, it's one of the, but if not the biggest, experiment in human history in terms of human resettlement. Well, why do I say that? It is because urbanization in China actually is not an entirely natural sort of process. Usually, urbanization happens by two sort of forces. One is the pull factor, and the other is the push factor. The pull factor means the attraction of cities to, the rural people. People are attracted by the, the neon light, the job opportunity, or the education opportunity that is offered by the city. And the push factor is where, in rural areas, people cannot really have any livelihood anymore. So there are these two factors that are working together, which is driving this urbanization process usually. But in the case of China and in several other Asian countries, I think the policy factor is playing really an important role as a key driver. For example, China has been, trying to promote urbanization for the past about 20 years, and it is very determined to keep that position and probably even gear up a little bit. The urbanization has been the top sort of policy agenda in the new government since President Xi Jinping and Premier Li Keqiang took their office. And there are a couple of sort of rationale behind this. First of all, I think urbanization and industrialization in China has been regarded as the two sort of engines, or sometimes translated as the wheels that carries the modernization and economic growth process in China. And this is actually quite easy to understand, because if you look at some of the developed countries, and then look at their urbanization ratio, usually they have much, much higher urbanization ratio For example, like OECD countries, they typically have like 70 to 90 or even 97, 98 percentile of their population living in cities. So it's quite natural for a developing country government think, okay, in order to achieve higher income, we have to promote urbanization. But there's a distinguish to make because there's a difference between, you know, correlation and causal relationships. So there has been a paper published in Science in 2008, I think, which was has conducted across, you know, country, you know, across the world, about 190 countries across the world, sort of panel analysis, granular causality analysis, I think, looking at whether there's actual causal relationship between urbanization and income growth. And then the conclusion there was that there wasn't any causal relationship between those two. But then we questioned this conclusion because this is cross-country sort of conclusion, not really coming from China, particular country context. So we used the same sort of method and then used a different sort of indicator of urbanization. And then we conducted the same analysis in China, and our analysis actually shows, in the case of China, urbanization does have causal sort of relationship between with the income growth, and there is a positive sort of feedback relationships between those two. So it is quite sort of natural for the Chinese government to think in order to achieve economic growth, they have to, you know, promote urbanization. And the second rationale for the Chinese government to promote urbanization is that the Chinese economy has been adopting this export-oriented sort of growth model. But in order to avoid this mid-income trap, they have to expand their domestic consumption base. And it is quite natural to think about urbanization as one of the, you know, vehicle to deliver it. Because in China, an average urban citizen earns about 3.2 times more than average rural population. So it is quite natural if you move lots of rural population to cities and then try to, you know, assuming their income level catch up with the average citizens in the city, then that will be a huge consumption power that can be released. And third rationale behind this top governmental sort of priority is that urbanization is seen as a catalyst for regional development. Because in China, each farmer has very much limited sort of agricultural land. They have less than 0.1 hectare each farmer, which is really small. You know, it's almost like a little larger than average sort of our, you know, residential lot in Canberra, for example. So there are very limited sort of capacity for the Chinese farmers to achieve economic growth simply based on their, you know, agricultural production. So by moving some of the poor rural population to cities, it is assumed that it can free up some of the land that they hold, and then, you know, open the room for scaled up modern sort of farming practices. So those are some of the rationale behind why the Chinese government is really keen to promote urbanization in China. And if you look at this rationale, you can see there is one core element in it, which is development. But of course, the Chinese government realized it, and then they stress again and again that they won't do it in a sustainable sort of manner. And of course, they just have to do it in a sustainable manner. For example, like I have a couple of statistics here. For example, like 80% of world heavy crane are concentrated in the coastal China. And about 40% of the world construction material are used in China. So it is very, you know, quite natural for you to imagine, you know, the Chinese supply of construction material alone cannot really catch up with its demand. So you just have to think about some of the possibility of doing it in a sustainable way. And the Chinese government do have some plan about that. For example, the 12th five-year plan says they will reduce about 30%, improve like 30% of land productivity to, you know, preserve the land resource. And then they will reduce 16% of energy intensity of its economy, and then reduce 17% of carbon emission intensity over during the 12th five-year plan. Of course, there's a catch behind this, because if the income of the new resident, that they do catch up with the, you know, the citizens, the average level in cities, then this sort of consumption power can really drive the economic growth. But on the other hand, they also have sustainability consequences. There was a study, I think, published a couple of months ago, which says that if the Chinese citizens' consumption catch up with the level of USA, for example, then any sort of efficiency gain cannot really offset the growth in the absolute amount. I don't really want to leave you with the impression that urbanization is all bad in terms of sustainability or, you know, in terms of environment or in terms of carbon emission, because urbanization is also an sort of enormous opportunity, because change is always, you know, considered as an opportunity. If you look at the crisis, the world crisis in China, which is saying, you know, the crisis and then the opportunity staying together. So rapid urbanization can be an enormous opportunity to introduce sustainable technology as well as sustainable practices at a sort of national scale. And the latest urbanization plan, for example, does highlight a couple of those opportunities. For example, it is aiming to drastically improve the share of green buildings in all new constructions in China from a 2% in 2012 to 50% in 2020. So you can imagine this is, can be a drastic sort of improvement in terms of sustainability outcome. And they're going to do this through improving their green building codes and certificate and accreditation system, and making some of the adoption compulsory, and also develop some of the green construction materials. Another example is that the plan also says they are aiming to improve the share of public transportation in bigger cities with 1 million or above population from current 45% to 60% by 2020. So this can be another significant sort of improvement. And also they say they are going to increase the share of renewable energy consumption in cities and towns from 8.7%, you know, the current level, 2012, to 13%. I noticed from Professor Yang's presentation, the current renewable energy consumption level is about 8.4%. So currently, the city's renewable energy share is a little larger than, bigger than national level. But it's interesting, if you look at the 2020 level, the national target is 15%, but the city target is 13%. Now, I don't know what is actually exactly behind this discrepancy, but anyway, they are aiming to achieve some sort of improvement there as well. And also, another target there is that the share of prefecture and above level cities that actually meet the national air quality standard will be improved from current 40% to 60%. And I think this has significant meaning for energy and carbon emission, because usually any measures that really target at air quality improvement, they also have energy and carbon co-benefit. So I think it is really important to identify some of the innovative practices and try to build up transferable knowledge and, you know, facilitate cross-city learning. Because if you look at some of the front runners in China and in other, you know, countries, they can do some amazing sort of things. For example, like in Rizhao City in China, they have somehow succeeded in proliferating the solar water heater to 99% of their citizens through various sort of measures, stick and carrot combined, and, you know, awareness enhancing activities. So if they do want to do something, they actually can do something, especially at the city level. So I think this high level policy intervention, like the China's strategic plan for urbanization, if they are done properly, they can be a really powerful force for good. But I think in order to succeed, the Chinese government really need to adopt a tailored and really adaptive sort of approach that can engage with the local society and local environmental, you know, cultural sort of context, and also allow some of the local innovations to happen. another thing I think I picked up from Matt's presentation talking about the US Embassy's initiative to publicize the PM 2.5 data in Beijing. I think this actually highlights the potential of some of the growing middle class in cities. They can really become a very powerful force that can push the Chinese government to take action to reduce the air quality, the air pollution, which will have co-benefit for the carbon and energy front. And I would like to conclude this talk by really highlighting that cities are really at the forefront of this energy and carbon sort of debate, which is very often under-recognized. There's a favorite quote I often quote, which is by several UNDP administrators and, you know, Bill Clark at Harvard, which says, "The battle for sustainability is lost or won in cities." So I think we really need to recognize the positive and potential positive role cities can play in terms of climate change discussion, and also better engage with cities in terms of, you know, how you can actually realize some of the goals that are set up by, you know, through some of the international negotiations such as the IPCC process. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank, and thank you everybody for coming in. It's certainly a privilege to be on a panel with such distinguished speakers. I'm conscious that we, the panel, hope that there would be a good opportunity for questions to be asked, so I will be fairly brief. I suppose what I'd propose to do is give you a very brief introduction to the C20. Then a brief opinion on why the Australian presidency in Brisbane provides an opportunity for to address climate change, what has been done so far, and what WWF at least believes could be done. I'll give you three examples, which are comparatively straightforward, not easy, but comparatively straightforward, and three more ambitious things that the government could aspire to. The C20 is a organisation that was set up to provide civil society, which is the term used commonly overseas for non-government organisations, input into the G20. There was and is a Business 20, which provides the perspective of the private enterprise. There's also a L20, which provides a perspective of organised labour, and so on. So there's a number of interest groups, and the C20 is one of them. It was first established in Mexico. It received a lot of support from the Russian presidency last year, and we have received very good support from the Australian presidency this year. And we're preparing for the Turkish presidency next year now. The reason the G20 provides a significant opportunity, in our view, I should say, the views I'm expressing now are not yet the views of the adopted views of the C20. The C20 summit is to be held on Friday and Saturday this week, and it will only be after that that a consolidated and adopted view will be able to be expressed. So in a sense, the views I'm expressing now are the views of WWF. The G20 is really the Pareto principle in operation. It's got 20 parties to it, 19 countries plus the EU. Those parties produce 80% of the world's emissions, and they're responsible for 85% of economic activity. So if there is to be a solution to climate change, and we sincerely hope there will be, the majority of countries in that room must support it. The G20 meeting in Brisbane is also being held seven months out from the UNFCCC, the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, talks in Paris in 2015. So at the point that the G20 is held, most of the governments all the governments in the room, will be very advanced in their preparations for the UNFCCC conference. They'll also have a good idea about the positions of the other countries. So this really provides a splendid opportunity for a group of very important countries to identify and address the key impediments to a climate change, a deal at the UNFCCC meeting in Paris. And there has been some good work being done to date, and there's some good work being done right now. There is an existing commitment by the G20 to phase out inefficient fossil fuel subsidies by 2020. There is also a good work being done on energy efficiency. But notwithstanding the commitments and the good work, energy efficiency by itself cannot offset the growth in absolute emissions. And although there has been a commitment on fossil fuels, it has largely been delayed by a long discussion about what inefficient means, and also understandable degree of political inertia. So what could the G20 do? And I don't propose to rehearse the debate in the media about whether or not the G20 or whether or not climate change is an economic issue. It is clearly an economic issue. It will have severe impacts on the global economy. And even leaving that aside, energy is the heart and soul of a modern economy. And I also won't address another issue which is raised, which is that it's too difficult to get agreement, because that's just an outrageous cop-out by our leaders. Every international agreement is difficult. And so unless we are prepared to tackle the most difficult ones, the difficult ones will not be solved. One argument that does have some validity is that it may undermine the UNFCCC process. And that is an issue that we must be concerned about. But notwithstanding that, I think there is a number of, or WWF would suggest that there's a number of things that can be done at the G20, none of which will undermine the UNFCCC process. The first one is the G20 could commit to phase out fossil fuel subsidies by 2020. There are numerous reports by the IMF, the World Bank, the IEA, indicating that there is a very large amount of money, $1.9 trillion-ish, going into fossil fuels subsidies each year. Freeing up that for more efficient use would be an enormous benefit to the world economy. The second step, again, perfectly doable, would be to adopt to a five-year plan, or to agree to prepare and adopt at Turkey, the G20 in Turkey next year, a five-year plan to deliver a step change in energy efficiency through a mix of its standards, incentives and investment. Energy efficiency is a well-trawled over area. There's very little new to be done. All that needs to be done is to take the steps to implement it. The third relatively straightforward thing that the G20 could do that would increase the likelihood of a successful talks in Paris would be to develop a climate finance roadmap. Essentially, climate finance is one of the sticking points in the UNFCCC negotiations. Broadly speaking, climate finance really just means providing funds to developing countries to enable them to take a more expensive in the short term, but less expensive in the long term, clean path to development. China has said that it does not require any funding for this, so has Brazil. But both of them rightly say that unless funding is in place for other countries, effective treaty will not be reached. So essentially every donor, nearly every major donor, there is actually quite a few very generous donors, but who are not in the room, but nearly every major donor is in the room. And so to put together a roadmap, which could be released before the Paris talks, would greatly improve both the atmosphere of the Paris talks, but also the likelihood of success. Finally, there's a couple of things that are more ambitious still, but would increase by a very significant margin the likelihood of a solution to climate change in Paris. One would be for all G20 countries to adopt national emission reduction caps, energy efficiency targets, and renewable energy targets, because we know that the bundle of those three mandatory targets is essential to transform our energy supply. The second would be to commit, like the World Bank and a number of other governments, to no longer use public funds to pay for new coal infrastructure. Coal is by far the most polluting source of energy. Whatever the private sector may do, and they will be guided by the caps that are set up by governments, public money should not go into this most dangerous form of development. And finally, there will be a lot of infrastructure planning proposed and hopefully done at the G20 this year. All those infrastructure plans should be both climate resilient and promote clean development. So in summary, the G20 in Brisbane this year under the Australian presidency provides a splendid opportunity to set up Paris for success. It doesn't replace Paris, but certainly the group of countries that form the G20 can show what they are prepared to do to address this issue so that other countries can feel confidence that process is starting to work.
So floor is open for questions. We've got a roaming mic. Yan Hong has had. I've got a question in the back. Just to get us started, I'd like to ask you, Dr. Yan. I think it seems like China is quite on a quite different development trajectory with regard to energy and emissions than the United States. So we had U.S. emissions peaking in 2007 and now clearly declining. And most experts that I speak to seem to think that the peak in Chinese emissions is probably going to occur in the 2020s at much lower per capita GDP than the US. So just wondering if you wanted to comment on that.
They have many prediction or scenario study about energy consumption and CO2 emissions. And I think is that in my slides you can see if based on the 2 degree temperature scenario and CO2 emission have to be no later than 2020. And so in this case, for the coal cap, that have to be 2015 have to reach, coal consumption have to reach the peak. Another indicate, I would like to say, if we can demonstrate the CO2 emission reach the peak, first is the energy or CO2 emissions per capita have to go the peak for these two assumptions have to go first. Or coal have to go first. If we don't see anything is a coal consumption by gap peak, the energy consumption by capita or CO2 consumption by capita gap peak, so it's hard to say the national emission cap can be soon or later will come up.
Question in the back, and it's always welcome if you state your name and your
affiliation. Hi, my name's Hakir. Thanks to all the speakers, fascinating presentations. A couple of questions. Firstly, for Prof White, lots of interesting themes there, but I just want to ask for a book recommendation because I think it's an interesting area, and if you could just have a think about something that picks that up, that would be very much appreciated. My other real question, though, is about, firstly, it seems we haven't priced fossil fuels properly at the moment. So there are the costs of carbon, direct environmental impacts, whether it's health, etc. And then on the other side, we have fossil fuels. So in Australia, and this is to Mr. Murray, we have the impact of a strong fossil fuel industry who obviously will be affected by the proper pricing of that. I wanted to ask how the US is managing that relationship and will continue to manage that going forwards. And then to you, Dr. Young, whether that's different in China because of the political structure and what opportunities or how that affects any action that China might take. Is it freer to proceed?
All right. Thanks for your question. I think one of the really important things in the United States that we've been doing specifically over the last decade is we've very much been consulting with the business community and specifically the energy sector on the steps that we're taking. And in fact, a lot of the innovations that have really been developed on the clean energy side have been led by energy companies, have been led by the business community. So I think one of the points that our ambassador stressed when he was in Melbourne is that we really see where this is not for and against, or you know, a conflict between our reducing emissions and being profitable businesses or being profitable energy companies. That really we can do both together, and that the business community can play a role in doing so. I think I'd be happy to send you some more information later on some of the projects that I'm referring to, but really, the bottom line being that we see the business community as being part of the solution, rather than part of the problem. I think, here in Australia, and I definitely saw this when I was with the ambassador in Melbourne, there certainly also are a number of business interests that have really been pushing for clean energy, that have really been pushing innovation in this area. And, our view is that, this can continue to happen, and it doesn't have to be for and against. You're either for reducing carbon emissions or you're, for economic growth. We believe if you're looking at developing clean energy solutions, if you're looking at innovation, then there's a way that we can do both side by side.
Yeah, to answer your question, I think that's definitely price is a strong signal for the market. And for the coal, unfortunately, coal is very cheap. Because the economy go to recession, and now coal is price is a drop very significantly, and so that make coal is very competitive. So one way we overcome this kind of barrier, and we carry out study we call the coal benefit. So we have to estimate a coal from exploration, transportation, combustion, all these. Processes, and what is social or environment cost embedded. So we estimate at least put all these together, the coal price will increase is 70% to 80%. So in this case, of course, renewable definitely will much in advantage. However, and the government, so far, they cannot say, I have to put a price or other tax on the coal to increase 70 to 80%. But now they have two tax is under discussion, and one tax will be implemented very soon. That is the resources. So resources, if can be excised, and so the price for coal will increase about 5 to 6%. But another is a carbon tax. But now we argue ETS is a better market mechanism towards or a carbon tax. If we impose the carbon tax on coal, So that's called that the price will increase about 10% to 15%. So this is now is a much feasible the policy government like to adopt. Of course, we have to argue about the environment cost and the environment regulation and standards have to follow. For the natural gas, that is heavily subsidized by government. So in this area, we have to phase out subsidization. And compared to the international market or pipeline price or LNG price, domestic price, natural gas price is only 40 to 60% lower. So that is heavily subsidized. So we have to move this out. And for the oil, and oil actually is in the market price. And so we like to see any cost and damage for the environment and the CO2 emission. So I think it's for Chinese to move this subsidization for the fossil fuel. I think that is quite important. But fortunately, we have to also concern about our CO2 emission. If we have a emission cap, so that can be phase out the fossil fuel much sooner.
Well, just a very brief answer. I'm going to fail to resist the temptation to suggest that in a large and complex literature, not a bad place to start is a little book called The China Choice, Why America Should Share Power, published by Black Ink, written by me.
Scott White from the Delegation of the European Union. I have a question for Dr. Yang. I notice in your a very good presentation that you didn't make a lot of reference to carbon capture and storage. So I was just wondering, in your opinion, what role you see for CCS in the Chinese context. Thanks.
The CCUS have argued or is a debate in China for a long time. And China now consumes more than half the coal in the world. So I think in this case, if Chinese phase out coal, maybe take a long time. But another challenge is that we have to develop a CCUS. Fortunately, the private sector is more active than the government. Government at this moment is only put a little money for the R&D. But private sector, for instance, power sector like Shenhua, Guodian, and also is number one coal producer in Shenhua. They have their CCS project there. And I think is that we have to increase the private sector because for this private sector, they have their view. They are afraid in the future they can survive or not. So that is a kind of motivation and increase the private sector involved.
Thank you very much. Li Gangsong from Crawford School. I'd like to ask Dr. Yang again on the energy and climate change policy in China. So you're talking about China's government set a target to reach the peak level in about 10 to 15 years' time. But we were thinking that this is actually the peak level is the average for China. But we know China has a very different, vast and different regions. And the different regions have a very different income levels. Perhaps the richest and the poorest, the income gap is about 10 times. So in a way that if you look at the issue in the context of an environmental cuisine's yield curve, that means the rich region reached the peak and the poor region still yet to come. So in the way there is a risk very interesting public policy issues in the way to design the institution or even policy in accommodating the poor region, for example, in complying to the nationwide requirement for the carbon and for the emission, et cetera. So otherwise, the dirty industry will migrate from the coast in responding to the rising cost to the inland and the poor region. So therefore, overall, China will have a very difficult task to reach that average, the peak level. There is another dimension which is actually bringing the international dimension. If Chinese industries, manufacturing, we'll move the dirty industry offshore. So what will happen on the international front? Again, raising that, you know, the broader issues about how to handle that through international corporations. Thanks.
This is a good question. I give you an example. Now we have a study called CAP. That is not only is a nationwide code cap, but also is a sectorial code cap. We can disaggregate the national code cap to the different sector. For instance, power sector, iron, steel, cement, building sector, and coal chemical sector. But also is quite important because they have a leakage about the pollution. And now more power plant and more coal chemical now move to the west. So to avoid this kind of leakage, so we every provinces and every region, and we have a put coal cap in that case. So for instance, coastal area, the coal cap is a little lower, but ask them to implement sooner to get the, you know, under this coal cap. But we also give a cap in the west. We say in a couple years later, you cannot exceed this coal cap to avoid you develop a more coal-fired or, you know, coal-driven or use coal the enterprise there. So I think that is one way to avoid. And this coal cap in a different region also increase the trade, like carbon trade or other trade, or even they can shift money from coastal area to the poor area, like in the western area.
Up here, I'd like to thank again all the panelists for speaking today. My question was prompted by the comments from Professor White, but it's open to the panel. Since, I guess, economic liberalisation of China in the 70s, much of the domestic legitimacy of the Chinese government, or it's been argued that much of its legitimacy has rested on the fact that it's been able to guarantee economic development for its people and lift hundreds of millions of people out of poverty. One of the consequences of its economic industrialization, however, has been a great deal of environmental degradation. Now, I'm interested in, I guess, the domestic pressures on the Chinese government to act on climate change. So far, we've already seen dwindling water resources, droughts, significant air pollution in major cities. Once the future impacts of climate change become apparent, like more extreme weather events, rising sea levels and things like that, how will the Chinese government respond to, say, domestic pressures on it to respond to climate change and maintain not only the economic but I guess also the environmental well-being of its population?
I think for anybody who wants to have a go at it.
Okay.
Well, Matt should start.
Sure, I can start on that just in terms of my time there and then, you know, working on it on the U.S.-China relationship for almost about 10 years. I think we're already seeing quite a bit of that, and that's, I think, what's part of the reason that we've had an opening over the past few years to really engage China on a much wider range of issues. I think, in particular, the air pollution, the very serious air pollution incidents that China experienced, particularly I think it was January 2012, and then following, really affected the middle class in China, just as Dr. Bai was saying earlier. And so I think from the U.S. perspective, I mean, we've definitely seen an opportunity to engage more with China to talk about these issues. Because the leadership is increasingly serious about addressing them. So while the problems themselves, the environmental degradation itself, is a serious concern, I think the silver lining, if you will, is that Chinese leaders are much more interested in engaging, interested in international cooperation on this issue, and interested in being responsive to that growing middle class in China.
If I can just add a thought to that, and I certainly don't regard myself as an expert on Chinese domestic politics, but I do think that, you know, one of the most striking things about the Chinese government is, although it works very differently from ours, say, it has the same problem. That is, it's got to please its public on all sorts of different things, many of them mutually incompatible. You know, more services, lower taxes, all that sort of stuff. And so just like everybody else, the Chinese government has got very strong incentives to keep the economy growing, very strong incentives to deal with problems of pollution, very strong incentives to strengthen China's place in the world and establish its dignity and status and all that sort of thing, and these pull them in different directions. And I think although the way in which public expectations are filtered through to the policy-making process are different, I think the process still works. The other side of the coin, of course, is that in countries all around the world, in China as well as elsewhere, governments have a significant capacity to define these problems, to shape the way public see them. I'm going to allow myself to say you can see that work in Australia in recent years. One of the striking things about the Chinese government for the last few years, it seems to me, is that they've chosen to acknowledge and address the problem of climate change very frankly, to say this is one of the things we have to fix. They had a choice about that. They could have told their publics a different story, as other governments have done. They haven't so far. One of the challenges will be to hope that they keep on taking that approach.
Just picking up on the last point, I think when we talk about this public awareness and public pressure, we very often talk about one side sort of pressure, like the public is putting pressure to the government. But actually, if you look at what happens, actually there is a both side kind of feedback. For example, like a couple of years ago, Pew Center did a survey asking USA and Chinese citizens, say, to what degree do you think the global change and climate change is a big issue? I think in China there was about 78% or something, very high majority saying this is a very big issue and then we would like to have the government to deal with this issue. I think this is partly because of the government effort. Where, if you look at TV, sometimes they have this public government advertisement saying, we have to protect our ecosystem. And then, some of the mentioning of climate change as well. So I would like to say this is a both sides sort of interaction rather than one side to the other. And the second point I would like to mention is that you just mentioned this risk factor, especially probably in the coastal region. I would say if I look at the new urbanization strategy, I think the risk factor is very under addressed. And this is this view is also shared with some of my colleagues in China. I'm just back from China last week. So we're really, as someone who's working on urban system, we'd really like to see that the government, take a more sort of anticipating and forcing kind of role in terms of taking the risk into account when they plan urbanization and then building cities in China.
Usually government action is very slow until they have a crisis or big challenge. Mm-hmm. And for the environment issue and air quality, you can see now is a kind of a crisis. So fortunately, Chinese government take action very quickly. But before they are very slow because they didn't see this is a big challenge of the environment. And based on the Chinese expert study, now for the Chinese industrialization, now is in the phase of what we call the post-industrialization. That means industrialization will not go up again, and we will maybe maintain plateau for the production or even decline. So for iron steel, now reach the peak already. And for cement, maybe 2015 or 2016 or so reach the peak. So for all these energy intensive products, maybe is in the plateau or in decline. So on the other hand, this is good news for the climate change.
The power of public opinion. We're past 2:00. We've got two more questions lined up. I think we'll take them together for one last round of responses from the forum.
My question is for Professor Bai. I was interested in your comments about the potential of cities in terms of their contribution to the climate change problem. When we look at cities as decision-making systems, what we see when we disaggregate them is a lot of fine-grained complexity, a lot of regulatory issues at local council levels, at local decision-making levels. There are always huge compliance issues. And when we look at the empirical reality, we see that there are always issues about what to do about old building stock, the percentage of green buildings as a percentage of buildings in cities generally is very low, even with various incentives, and it always comes back to a question of cost. So I was wondering if you could say a little bit more about how you overcome a lot of this regulatory reality, as it were, overcoming a lot of these micro problems in order for cities to really achieve this macro objective that you talked about, which seems plausible and good. You know, how does one green cities, and particularly in the context of China, I guess?
My question is to Hugh White. Regarding the comments you made before about the current situation with the US and China, potentially it could deteriorate, could improve, or the status quo could be maintained. So I didn't really understand how this impacted on the climate. You may mention that there was a risk movement to a lower carbon economy. You also mentioned that China's economy will overtake the US and what impact that would have in real terms. And energy security.
Joing. I'll give a very brief answer. I think there's, as I touched on in my remarks, I think there are a number of different ways in which the present reality of strategic rivalry between the US and China, and the risk that rivalry will escalate, and they're two separate points. Can affect both what each country does individually in relation to changing their energy economies, reducing their carbon emissions, and to their capacity to cooperate in achieving things like a good outcome in Paris next year. And it partly relates to the way they see one another as competitors. And so, for example, the more they see one another as competitors, and the more they're conscious of them. Of themselves being, as I think they are, in a competition to see who has the bigger economy, because that is in the end determines who's got the most power, and I think it is as brutal and simple as that, in essence, will factor in, will not be a sole determinant, but will factor into their judgments about how far they're prepared to sacrifice economic growth in order to achieve lower emission energy outcomes. It will also affect the way in which they see one another as negotiating partners / competitors, and I think it will particularly affect the politics of selling negotiated outcomes to their domestic audiences. As I said before, I don't know enough about Chinese politics to know how that would work, but it's not very hard to envisage the situation in which a US president takes a deal to the Congress and some of the congressmen say, hell, you're giving away too much to China. And the more competitive the relationship, the harder that will be to get past. And the last point is that if, as I think is far from a certainty, and in fact not a very high likelihood, but considering how serious it would be, a likelihood we have to take into account very significantly, if the US and China find themselves in an armed conflict, not an impossible possibility, then I think the chance of cooperation on climate change or anything else goes straight out the window. It blots everything else out. So that's a relatively low probability but very high consequence possibility that looms out there at the edge of the future space. Low, but not that low. I think I reckon it's higher than most other people do because I've got a very gloomy imagination.
Is it okay if I also add, if I could add something to that? As the U.S. government representative on the panel, just want to offer an alternative alternate narrative. Just very simply and very briefly, we welcome the rise of China. We've said that, our president said that, our secretaries have said that. There's been bipartisan support for that over the last 30 some years. We've said it repeatedly. We want to engage China across the board. That doesn't mean we'll never have disagreements. Of course we will. We have disagreements with any country, diplomatically, politically, economically, and we're going to have disagreements with China, but we want to continue to engage China across the board. And lastly, as I talked about in my remarks, we really believe that this energy and climate space is one of those growing opportunities where we can do more with China. And you know, so I would put it more as the glasses half full person up here. But you know, that's something that I've seen myself over the last 10 plus years, and I hope we'll be able to continue to do that.
Yeah, may I jump in?
I agree with Matt. If based on my observation, you know, we have a strategic dialogue between the U.S. and China is more than 10 years already. So I don't see, because I'm involved in the environment and climate change and energy area, this cooperation is very smooth. There are no big trouble, big fight in the environment, energy and climate change. And of course, other issues like military issues, South China Sea issues, of course they have some conflict. But I don't see in the future, you know, they have a big, you know, fight between U.S. and China. Of course, we, in the future, we have a more, you know, competition in the economy area, even in other areas. But I think it's a, I think both countries smart, leader are smart to settle down this. And even, you know, my observation for the Chinese leaders, they don't like to have a very strong, you know, other, in a conflict with the U.S. Of course, they like to dialogue. For China, they like to see the first time in the world they can see the you know, peaceful race or peaceful development can work in these two big countries or not. If it doesn't work, then it's a big disaster for the world.
So can I come to the city question? I certainly agree with you. It is easy to say that cities have lots of potential, but it is really hard to realize those potential. And I think it's particularly because try to address some of the global issues at the city level. There are this scale mismatch, I call them. For example, you know, you have this temporal scale mismatch. If you have an, you know, elected mayor, you know, his concern is probably 3 to 5 years within his office time. But when we talk about global change, it's, you know, we're talking about 100 years of scenarios and things like that. So it's totally out of his, you know, temporal scale. And also there's a spatial scale issue. For example, a mayor will be concerned about whatever happening within their boundary, administrative boundary. But the global change issue doesn't have really a boundary. And then how to actually address those things within the city boundary. Sometimes they conflict with their local issues. For example, more pressing, you know, like how do you actually provide for urban poor, those sort of things. And also there's this institutional scale mismatch. For example, like city government, they have to work within this national and state government, you know, sort of system, and it is sometimes very hard for them to overjump and then say, we would like to do something for something that is global. So it is really hard, but on the other hand, I would really like to see, you know, like people to look at some of the stars. There are some of the very good front-runner cities in the world, and despite all the, you know, they just beat all the odds and they can do lots of good things. So my approach to this is that rather than try to give a, you know, one-size-fits-all kind of solution, I would really like to see how some of the front-runners could do that. And then by doing a more systematic sort of analysis, looking at, you know, those front-runners across different cases and different contexts, we probably can find out something that can be, you know, transferable, can be, you know, learned by others. And I would like to quote Tolstoy's, you know, Anna Karenina, you know, the novel's opening sentence, which says, you know, all happy families are alike, but all, you know, each and every unhappy families, they have their own misery. This is, you know, paraquote from Chinese translation, because I read that in Chinese. So I would like to forget about those, you know, unhappy families for a moment and then focus on why some of those happy families can be happy and what are some of the, you know, alike commonalities among, you know, some of the happy cities. So that would be my answer.